From New York, this is Democracy Now!
I think all of you know we won the popular vote in Iowa. We won the New Hampshire primary. And according to three networks in the AP, we have now won the Nevada caucus.
Senator Bernie Sanders scores a decisive victory Saturday in the Nevada Democratic presidential caucuses, riding a wave of support from Latinx voters who strengthened his status as Democratic presidential frontrunner. We'll get response from Erica Andiola with Raisa's Action and New York University professor Christina Beltran. Then Sanders' sweep has rocked the Democratic establishment.
Senator Sanders believes in an inflexible, ideological revolution that leaves out most Democrats, not to mention most Americans.
I ain't a socialist. I ain't a plutocrat. I'm a Democrat.
We'll host a debate on Bernie Sanders and democratic socialism with two economists, Nobel Prize-winning economist, New York Times op-ed columnist Paul Krugman, and socialist economist Richard Wolff. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Bernie Sanders won the Nevada caucuses by a landslide, earning just over 47% of the vote, with 88% of precincts reporting. He more than doubled Joe Biden's vote count, who came in second at 21%. Pete Buttigieg came in third with close to 14%. Senator Elizabeth Warren placed fourth with 10% of the vote. Entrance polls showed Sanders picking up the most votes across many demographic categories, in particular among Latinx voters, where he received over half of the vote. Senator Sanders addressed his supporters at a victory speech in San Antonio, Texas, Saturday night.
In Nevada, we have just put together a multi-generational, multi-racial coalition, which is going to not only win in Nevada, it's going to sweep this country.
Earlier on Saturday, Sanders had visited the memorial outside the El Paso Walmart, where 22 people were killed, dozens wounded in a mass shooting in August. Former presidential candidate Marianne Williamson endorsed Bernie Sanders following his Nevada win. She wrote of her decision, quote, a 40-year-old trend of capitalism without conscience, corporate elites and their errand boys in government have created the inevitable blowback in the form of a political revolution. That revolution is the one that Bernie Sanders now leads. Marianne Williamson previously endorsed Sanders' 2016 presidential bid. Seven presidential hopefuls will square off in another debate Tuesday night in South Carolina, ahead of the state's primary Saturday. Two billionaires will appear on the stage, former New York Mayor Mike Bloomberg and Tom Steyer, whose rising numbers in South Carolina's polls appear to be eroding Joe Biden's support. Meanwhile, calls are mounting for MSNBC host Chris Matthews to resign following his remarks comparing Senator Sanders' Nevada victory to Nazi Germany's takeover of France.
I'm reading last night about the fall of France in the summer of 1940, and the general, Renault, calls up Churchill and says, it's over. And Churchill said, how can it be? You got the greatest army in Europe. How can it be over? He said, it's over. So I had that suppressed feeling. I can't be as wild as Carville, but he is damn smart, and I think he's damn right on this one.
Bernie Sanders' communications director, Mike Kaska, responded to Matthews' comment on Twitter, saying, quote, never thought part of my job would be pleading with a national news network to stop likening the campaign of a Jewish presidential candidate whose family was wiped out by the Nazis to the Third Reich. But here we are, he said. In China, President Xi Jinping described the coronavirus outbreak as the largest public health emergency since the founding of Communist China, as the government delayed the meeting of the National People's Congress for the first time in decades. Worldwide, the number of infections is nearing 80,000, with over 2,600 deaths. South Korea has issued the highest level of alert, as six people have now died from the disease, with over 800 infected. In Italy, 150 cases have now been confirmed, including three deaths. 10 Italian towns are now on lockdown, and the Venice Carnival was cut short. In Iran, eight deaths have been reported, prompting border closures with Afghanistan and Turkey. Back in the United States, the Trump administration's backed off plans to house patients from the Diamond Princess cruise ship at a base in Alabama after local officials threatened to sue over the planned move. President Trump arrived in India today, where he appeared at a massive rally with Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi in Gujarat. A reported 100,000 people packed a massive cricket stadium where Trump touted a $3.5 billion U.S.-India defense deal as he delivered a speech under the banner of Namaste Trump. Some rallygoers reportedly started leaving the event because Trump's remarks were not being translated. Trump also claimed, quote, India is a country that proudly embraces freedom, liberty, individual rights, despite the brutal government crackdown on Muslim Indians, as it enacts its controversial new citizenship law and the ongoing repression in Kashmir. In Afghanistan, the U.S. military and the Taliban have begun a week-long partial truce ahead of the expected long-anticipated peace deal. The U.N. said in a report released Saturday, over 10,000 civilians were killed or injured from the ongoing conflict in 2019, and over 100,000 civilians have been killed or injured over the past decade. In Iran, conservative candidates affiliated with the Revolutionary Guards picked up the majority of parliamentary seats in an election that saw the lowest voter turnout since the 1979 revolution. Over 7,000 possible candidates were disqualified ahead of the elections, the first since the U.S. resumed harsh sanctions against Iran. In Gaza, a Palestinian man was killed Sunday by Israeli forces, prompting international outcry after a video went viral showing an Israeli bulldozer scraping up his body. The incident was followed by rocket fire from Gaza and Israeli airstrikes. Elsewhere in the occupied Palestinian territories, Israeli police shot dead a man in East Jerusalem Saturday. The police say he was attempting. Meanwhile, Senator Bernie Sanders has said he will not attend the annual APEC conference again this year. That's the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee. He tweeted, quote, "The Israeli people have the right to live in peace and security. So do the Palestinian people. I remain concerned about the platform APEC provides for leaders who express bigotry and oppose basic Palestinian rights. For that reason, I will not attend their conference," Sanders tweeted. In Canada, Tech Resources has withdrawn its application for the $15.5 billion Alberta oil sands frontier mine days before the Canadian government of Prime Minister Justin Trudeau was to announce whether it would allow the project to go ahead. It would have been the largest ever open pit mine and was expected to pump around 260,000 barrels of oil per day, producing 4.1 megatons of emissions each year. Indigenous and environmental groups have been sounding the alarm over the proposed mine. Last week, a group of Nobel Prize winners called on Trudeau to stop the Tech Frontier mine. Indigenous Climate Action, which led the grassroots campaign against the project, celebrated the announcement, writing, quote, "Our communities need a just transition, not more fossil fuel resource extraction. We need to be in charge of our own futures, lands, and job opportunities that work to solve the climate crisis, address inequality, and respect our rights and sovereignty as Indigenous people," they said. Back in the United States, President Trump's new personnel chief, John McEntee, is reportedly directing agency heads to identify and purge anti-Trump staffers. Trump has tasked his former body man to rid agencies of the, quote, "bad people" and deep state. Trump also reportedly referred to anti-Trump employees as snakes. 29-year-old John McEntee was fired in 2018 by then-Chief of Staff General John Kelly because he was under investigation by Homeland Security for financial crimes. But McEntee was recently rehired to head the personnel office. Meanwhile, Axios is reporting the Trump administration's been gathering lists of disloyal government officials that they plan to kick out and replace with Trump loyalists. A network of Trump allies, including Jeanne Thomas, the wife of Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, is reportedly charged with creating the lists. One of those targeted is former U.S. Attorney Jesse Liu, whom Trump withdrew for consideration for a top Treasury role earlier this month. Jesse Liu's memo reportedly mentions her signing the sentencing filing requesting jail time for Michael Flynn, as well as holding a leadership role in a women's lawyers group that is, quote, pro-choice and anti-Alito. The Supreme Court voted 5-4 Friday to allow Trump's so-called public charge rule to go ahead by lifting a lower court injunction on the rule in Illinois. The measure seeks to severely limit the number of low-income immigrants by denying green cards and visas to anyone who may seek benefits like Medicaid, food stamps and housing vouchers. The Supreme Court lifted a nationwide injunction on the rule last month. Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor delivered a scathing dissent, writing, quote, claiming one emergency after another, the government has recently sought stays in an unprecedented number of cases, demanding immediate attention and consuming limited court resources in each. And with each successive application, its cries of urgency ring increasingly hollow. The court has been all too quick to grant the government's reflexive requests. But make no mistake, such a shift in the court's own behavior comes at a cost, Justice Sotomayor wrote. In more immigration news, BuzzFeed reports a 34-year-old Mexican man has died while in the custody of ICE, that's Immigration and Customs Enforcement, at a hospital in Ohio. His death marks the seventh death of an immigrant while in ICE custody during the 2020 fiscal year. And here in New York City, thousands of people from the Dominican community took to the streets of Washington Heights Saturday to protest the suspension of local elections in the Dominican Republic earlier this month. Anti-government protests have been ongoing since last week after the Dominican Central Electoral Board blocked municipal elections, alleging there was a technical glitch in the electronic voting machines. Voters say it's part of an attempt by the ruling political party to hold on to power. These are voices from Saturday's protest in Washington Heights.
I'm a professional who had to migrate from my country in search of a better future for my daughter. My daughter's generation needs that we truly wake up and that we clean up our country for them.
I believe that the elections brought a conclusion to a series of events. This was the last drop in a country that has endured too many abuses and corruption.
The last voice was actress Laura Gomez of Orange is the New Black. Dominican Republic officials are reportedly investigating the alleged ballot machine glitches and have rescheduled the municipal elections for March 15th. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Senator Bernie Sanders scored a decisive victory Saturday in the Democratic presidential caucuses in Nevada, riding a wave of support from young voters, union members and Latinx voters who strengthened his status as Democratic presidential frontrunner. In the third state to vote in the Democratic primaries and caucuses, former Vice President Joe Biden finished second place, with former Mayor Pete Buttigieg of South Bend, Indiana, in third, and Senator Elizabeth Warren trailing in fourth place. Senator Sanders addressed thousands of supporters at a campaign event in San Antonio, Texas, Saturday night after he was declared the winner in Nevada.
We are going to win across the country because the American people are sick and tired of a president who lies all of the time. They are sick and tired of a corrupt administration. They are sick and tired of a president who is undermining American democracy, who thinks he is above the law.
Entrance polls showed Senator Sanders picking up the most votes across many demographic categories, in particular among Latinx voters, where he received over half the vote. His win shows their potential to reshape the next stage of the Democratic presidential race. In the next 4 weeks, six more of the 12 states with a large Latinx population will vote in Democratic primaries. On Super Tuesday, Texas, California, and Colorado go to the polls. Arizona, Florida, and Illinois will vote on March 17th. For more, we're joined by two guests in Phoenix, Arizona, Erica Angiola, Chief Advocacy Officer for ISIS Action, the advocacy arm for the Refugee and Immigrant Center for Education and Legal Services. And here in New York, Christina Beltran is with us, Associate Professor, Director of Graduate Studies at New York University's Department of Social and Cultural Analysis, author of the book The Trouble with Unity, Latino Politics and the Creation of Identity. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Christina Beltran, let's begin with you. Talk about the level of organizing that went on in Nevada and the significance of this win with Bernie Sanders. The corporate media has been saying he doesn't have the support of communities of color, winning more than half of the Latinx vote.
Yeah, it was a stupendous victory for the Sanders campaign. And I think that, you know, I'm a political scientist by training and study Latino politics, and we have been talking about the issue of the way the Democratic Party treats Latino voters in terms of mobilizing Latinx populations in a very instrumental way, where they sort of talk about wanting this electorate, but they never put in the resources, they never put in the time. It is so—they typically kind of drop people in to do stuff at a very quick level. And so one of the things that's so amazing is this is one of those experiments of, like, what if you actually did the things that organizers and political scientists who think about mobilization and turnout, if you actually did what people have been talking about, which means that they went into grassroots organizations. They didn't just hire Democratic Party folks. They actually went into groups like Mi Gente. They went into groups like Take the Road, Make the Road. And they actually drew out those activists to tap into the political energy of these communities, and they put in the resources. I mean, I think something like every Democratic registered Latino was texted or emailed. They knocked on thousands and thousands of doors. So that kind of mobilization, I think, was just so critical. And I think the other thing that's really important about it was the youth element of this, is that, you know, young Latino voters, Latinx activists, were able to talk to their families and parents. And I think that also was really critical to creating this sort of multi-generational turnout, was you had voters who were actually also, you know, really talking to their families and having a collective conversation, the kind of tamales for Theo Bernie, the soccer events. They did this on a broad-based level that took seriously the activists and organizing energy of the community, not just seeing them as in an instrumental way, but as seeing them as activists and organizers themselves.
So let's talk about that idea of investing in organizers that mm-hmm. the DNC has had so much trouble with.
Right.
We're going to have Chuck Rocha on the show tomorrow, who is the Mexican-American main organizer of the Bernie campaign in Nevada. But this idea of investing in organizers almost will have parents be proud if their kid says, when they say, what are you going to be when you grow up? An organizer. But what that means to organize on the ground.
Right. I think it means really understanding the variety of issues, right, in a kind of lived way. But I think it's also understanding, often I think one of the biggest problems for Latinx communities is that they get described as monolithic. They get described as if they're all one thing. They get described, and so you hear these characterizations that they get targeted for just around the question of immigration, when it's really important to think about immigration as a solidarity issue, because voters obviously have citizenship. So you've got to talk about that as a solidarity question around mixed status families. So I think that organizing people really does involve people on the ground who have a deeper sense of the issues that affect these communities, people who really have a deep sense of those questions. So I think a lot of it is about recognizing that there's a deep history of labor organizing in these communities, the labor movement historically in this community, and we don't talk enough about the long history of Latino and Latinx labor organizing from people like Luisa Moreno and the pecan shellers unions in the 1930s, all the way to Cesar Chavez, to auto workers. There's just a long history of deep, and having activists who understand and know that history and then can mobilize it is deeply powerful. People need to feel like they're seen in all their diversity and all their difference and all their practices. And I think, you know, the Sanders campaign understood that, and they didn't try to, I think, micromanage that. One got the sense that they actually let organizers think on the ground with what they thought made sense in terms of how to reach out to communities. And so both trusting organizers and mobilizing organizers. And it takes money and resources to turn non-voters into voters, right? So you have big chunks of Latino, Latinx communities who have been voting. But you have a lot of new young voters. It's a young population. It's a population that is a more working-class population. Those are communities that take real resources to turn into voters. And it takes multiple touches to do that, and they did that.
And also, you have a kind of bucking of the leadership of the mm-hmm. Culinary Union, which, you know, represents thousands of service workers. I think Senator Sanders took something like 7 of the 8 casinos, and we're talking about thousands and thousands of workers that mm-hmm. the rank and file disagreed with the leadership, who didn't endorse anyone. Right. It's not like they endorsed Biden, for example, but they did say they weren't for Medicare for All.
Right. And I think
because they provided health insurance.
Right.
Themselves.
Right. There's good union health care there. And there's a debate about what that means in terms of what could get lost and what could be gained. I think what they don't understand, and I think this is something that Sanders has been really successful at, is he combines an ability sometimes at his best, right, to talk about very material, concrete things that people need alongside a social justice agenda, right? And that combination is powerful. And so I think two things happened. One, I think, is that you have a lot of culinary workers who are thinking about things beyond their healthcare. They're thinking about college education. They're thinking about mass incarceration. They're thinking about the deportation regime. So there were a lot of other issues to mobilize those voters and to make them feel like that was the candidacy they wanted to support. I think the second thing is a lot of those union workers have a lot of family who are in non-union jobs and have really precarious health care. And so I think there was a sense that it isn't just about the kind of narrow self-interest of protecting one's own quality health care, but a larger sense that there's a health care crisis beyond themselves and trying to think about what's going on with their children, their cousins, their grandchildren, you know, and all the people around them. So again, it's a combination of a kind of interest group and solidarity politics that I think he tapped into that allowed people to ultimately vote in a broader way than people might have imagined.
I wanted to bring in Erica Andiola and ask you about the protests that erupted at the end of last week's debate in Las Vegas. This was Wednesday night, just as former Vice President Joe Biden was giving his closing remarks. Erica, you and Lucia Allain, both of Raisa, shouted at Biden, "You deported 3 million people," a reference to the record pace of deportations under President Obama, "and no kids in changes, as well as don't look away. No kids in cages, as well as don't look away," as you were escorted from the auditorium. I wanted to play the clip of you that night, Erica Andiola, just after the protest.
Decided to interrupt. We're not sorry. The immigration debate today, immigration came the last issue that they talked about, and they didn't even have time to talk about the issue. This is not okay. We are being the most attacked by the Trump administration, and we deserve a conversation about how our lives are going to look like if any of those people get elected.
So that's Erica Andiola on Wednesday night. Erica, you're back in Arizona, also an extremely significant state, but you were in Nevada organizing there as well as protesting. Talk about the response to your protest and why you were there protesting in the Democratic presidential debate.
Yeah, of course. I mean, one of the biggest reasons why we were there is because there has been a growing frustration among a lot of us who have been organizing around immigrant rights for a really long time, and even within the community, that immigration doesn't come up as one of the issues that, you know, is debated or that is really hashed out as far as, like, what the policy should look like, what candidates want the policy to look like, at a time when we have news from the Trump administration almost every week about a change that has happened that's going to affect the community. And to us, it's scary just because we have had a Democratic president before Donald Trump took office. We had a Democratic president who was promising immigration reform, who was, his slogan was, si se puede, or yes, we can. And at the end of the day, he deported a record number of people. And many people said after the protest, well, why don't you go to Trump? Why don't you go protest Trump? He's the one doing all these things to kids, to families. Well, we have been fighting against Trump for 4 years, almost 4 years now. We've been really fighting against him. But in this particular occasion, we have the ability to change the debate on immigration within the Democratic Party. And what, Bernie's win showed in Nevada is that you can talk about a moratorium to deportations. He's one of the candidates who has that, in his platform. And you can still win. And that's one of the things that the Democratic Party has been really pushing back and really telling candidates and not really allowing for candidates to talk about the issue because they're so afraid that, talking about immigration is going to be a losing strategy for Democrats. And we don't think that that's the case. You can win. Bernie showed it in Nevada. And I think it's important that we continue to organize the community. And I completely agree with your other guest that it's about organizing. It's about talking to people on the ground and not taking Latino voters and immigrant voters for granted.
I wanted to ask you about this report in BuzzFeed. On Thursday, BuzzFeed wrote, Bernie Sanders' campaign reversed one part of his immigration platform, a blanket moratorium on deportations pending a policy audit. Instead, Sanders' campaign manager, Faiz Shakir, argued that while the moratorium on deportations would affect 99% of the people living here, it would not be absolute. The moratorium, he said, would not apply to, quote, violent criminals, and that some people serving time in prison would have a deportation decided on a case-by-case basis. If you could respond to that, Erica.
Yeah, I was actually in the room when that happened in Nevada, when all the surrogates and Tom Steyer were there, to talk about the issue. And first of all, it was, it was disappointing to see that the only, one candidate showed up and the rest of the folks were surrogates. No candidates decided to show up. And there hasn't been a real conversation about the issue again, whether it's at the debates or whether it's outside of the debates, there hasn't been an actual policy discussion within the candidates of what this issue should look like. And really, the devil's in the detail. This is exactly what we need to hear from the candidates, what they actually will do on immigration. And, it's easy to say we want a moratorium of deportations. We want to no kids in cages, right? Like, there's things that are easy to say, but if we don't hear policy, if we don't really hear what the plans are, it's hard to know what that's going to look like. I hope that, we are able to continue to hear from the Bernie campaign of how that looks like and that we're not coming back again to the same narrative that Obama had, that, you had felons versus families, because our criminal justice system is also broken. And so we can't, we can't just continue to say that without really giving the details of how that's going to look like. Who are those folks that they're calling, criminals? If it is people who have actually done, really violent crimes, or if it's people who really just have, criminal record because they crossed the border, or, because they did something, 20 years ago and it's still in the record, even though they have changed their lives. So, yeah, we need to hear more details, and that's why Racist Action is continuing to pressure, and that's why we disrupted the Democratic debate, because we need an actual debate on immigration from all the candidates.
Well, I want to thank you both for being with us. Also adding that when it came to the African-American vote in Nevada, Vice President Biden got 39% of the vote, Sanders 27%, and Steyer 16%. Going into South Carolina, this is extremely significant because 60% of the Democratic voters in South Carolina are African American. I want to thank Erica Angiola, Chief Advocacy Officer for Racist Action, speaking to us from Phoenix, Arizona, and Christina Beltran, Associate Associate Professor and Director of Graduate Studies in the Department of Social and Cultural Analysis at New York University. When we come back, we host a debate on Bernie Sanders and democratic socialism. We'll be joined by two economists, socialist economist Richard Wolff and the Nobel Prize-winning economist, New York Times op-ed columnist and economist Paul Krugman. Stay with us.
Once in my life, I have someone who needs me, someone I've needed so long. For once, unafraid, I can go where life leads me, and somehow I know I'll be strong. For once, I can touch what my heart used to dream of. Long before I knew someone warm like you would make my dreams come true. For once in my life, I won't let sorrow hurt me, not like it's hurt me before. For once I have something I know won't desert me, and I'm not alone anymore. For once I can say this is mine, you won't take it. Long as I know I have love, I can make it. For once in my life, I have someone who needs me.
For once in Life by Vegas crooner Frank Sinatra. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As we continue to look at Senator Bernie Sanders' runaway victory in Nevada, which cemented his position as the frontrunner for the Democratic presidential nomination. As Sanders' bid for the Democratic nomination looks more and more likely, and the Democratic Party establishment and much of the mainstream media are openly expressing concern about a self-described Democratic socialist leading the presidential ticket. His opponents, including former Vice President Joe Biden and former South Bend Mayor Pete Buttigieg, are also on the attack.
Senator Sanders believes in an inflexible, ideological revolution that leaves out most Democrats, not to mention most Americans.
I ain't a socialist. I ain't a plutocrat. I'm a Democrat.
That was Joe Biden, and before that, Pete Buttigieg. They were speaking on Saturday night after the results from the Nevada caucuses rolled in. Well, last week, during the primary debate in Las Vegas, Bernie Sanders addressed misconceptions about socialism.
Let's talk about democratic socialism. Let's talk about what goes on in countries like Denmark, where Pete correctly pointed out they have a much higher quality of life in many respects than we do. What are we talking about? We are living in many ways in a socialist society right now. Problem is, as Dr. Martin Luther King reminded us, we have socialism for the very rich, rugged individualism for the poor.
Wait a second.
When Donald Trump gets $800 million in tax breaks and subsidies to build luxury condominiums, that's socialism for the rich. We have to subsidize Walmart's workers who are on Medicaid and food stamps because the wealthiest family in America pays starvation wages. That's socialism for the rich. I believe in democratic socialism working people, not billionaires. Health care for all. Please. Educational opportunity for all.
So that was Bernie Sanders. For more, we host a debate on Bernie Sanders and democratic socialism. With us in our New York studio is the Nobel Prize-winning economist, the op-ed columnist for The New York Times, Paul Krugman. His latest book is just out. It's called Arguing with Zombies, Economics, Politics, and the Fight for a Better Future. One of his recent columns is headlined Bernie Sanders' isn't a socialist. Also with us in studio is Richard Wolff, professor emeritus of economics at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, visiting professor at the New School here in New York. He is the founder of Democracy at Work and hosts a weekly national TV and radio program called Economic Update. Among his books, his latest is called Understanding Socialism. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Well, what do you make of what is happening right now, Paul Krugman, with Bernie Sanders? So far, the clear frontrunner, but moving into South Carolina. And why that headline, Bernie Sanders is not a socialist, what you were getting at?
Bernie says he loves Denmark. I love Denmark. I think Denmark is an illustration of how decent a society can be. The Danes don't think that they're socialists. They think that they're social democrats. They don't use the word socialist. And it isn't socialism as we've always, used to understand it. It's not government ownership of the means of production. It's not seizing the commanding heights of the economy. It's a really strong social safety net and a strong labor movement, all of which I support. In Arguing with Zombies, I have a whole chapter called Eek Socialism, which is about the Republican habit of playing three-card Monty. You say that you're for universal health care. They say, that's socialist. You say you're for universal child care. They say, think about how many people Stalin killed. It's this crazy stuff. So why use the word? Why describe yourself? I think it's kind of self-indulgent to call yourself a socialist and, give the Republicans unnecessary ammunition. I'm for the same kinds of policies. I'm for universal health care, universal child care, all of these things. Why buy into the Republican effort to make this sound like something Stalin would do?
Well, he calls himself a democratic socialist, is that right?
That's cutting it way too fine. Why use the word?
Let me turn to a clip from the Democratic presidential debate in Las Vegas last week. First, we hear from Bernie Sanders, then Mike Bloomberg.
What we need to do to deal with this grotesque level of income and wealth inequality is make sure that those people who are working, Mr. Bloomberg, wasn't you who made all that money. Maybe your workers played some role in that as well. And it is important that those workers are able to share the benefits. Also, when we have so many people who go to work every day and they feel not good about their jobs, they feel like cogs in a machine. I want workers to be able to sit on corporate boards as well so they can have some say over what happens to their lives.
Mayor Bloomberg, you own a large company. Would you support what Senator Sanders is proposing?
Absolutely not. I can't think of a ways that would make it easier for Donald Trump to get reelected than listening to this conversation. It's ridiculous. We're not going to throw out capitalism. We tried that. Other countries tried that. It was called communism, and it just didn't work.
So there was Michael Bloomberg, the former mayor of New York City, going after Bernie Sanders. Richard Wolff, you describe yourself as a socialist economist. Respond to what both Paul Krugman says and what Bloomberg is saying here.
Sure. There is no agency, neither public nor private, that defines what a socialist is. If you follow the socialist movement for the last 150 years, you would discover that it has been a contested terrain from day one. There were different interpretations and different meanings. Bernie Sanders is perfectly in line with one of the traditions of what socialism is. It's the government having a big role in offsetting some of the awful qualities of capitalism. But we also know that the kind of control that the government tries to operate is very difficult for it to succeed with. We once had a New Deal in this country. We lost most of it because we didn't go beyond a government intervention to change the society. What Bernie Sanders represents is an awareness that it's time to have a conversation we should have had for 75 years about our capitalist system and whether we can do better. This is now a changed environment in which what was taboo in this country isn't anymore. And Bernie has already achieved the breaking of a taboo in this country to talk about socialism, its strengths and weaknesses, its different interpretations, and compare them to capitalism, rather than running away because nasty conservatives call us various names. That's not a profound reason. And for the young people of this country, it doesn't doesn't carry much weight anyway. So I welcome the opening that Bernie achieves, that we can talk about socialism, its different interpretations, and why we ought to explore them a lot more than we've been able to under the taboo of the last 75 years.
Paul Krugman.
I actually agree that a lot of young people have reacted. I mean, we have a 60-year-long campaign of equating any attempt to make American lives better with socialism. And a fair number of young people have said, well, in that case, I'm a socialist. The trouble is, you're not going to win this election without a fair number of old people, too. And it just seems to me that, again, it's self-indulgent to go down this route. I wish he wouldn't. I mean, if Sanders is the nominee, then Democrats are going to have to, you know, get behind him. And people like me are going to end up writing lots of things saying, you know, don't be scared. Yes, he uses the word socialist, but he doesn't actually mean what Republicans think want you to think he means. But, you know, who needed this, this extra thing? So the— I'm not sure that this is—I'm not sure I quite see what the point is. I mean, it seems to me that there's—to make the argument that says, I want social justice, I want a strong government safety net, I want worker empowerment, you can say all of those things without having to, you know, give ammunition to people who want to make it—make you sound like Stalin. So, I'm going to be spending—I expect—I expect Sanders will probably be the nominee, and I expect to spend a lot of the next year saying, look, he's really talking about Denmark, not Venezuela. But I shouldn't have to be doing that.
Richard.
I'm proud to be part of the socialist tradition. And I understand Paul's difficulty. He's having to defend now a centrism that's being rejected by a large number of people. The stunning reality is that the majority of young people, at least age 35 and under, no longer think that socialism is a bad word, and they are immune to that. And the young people are the future of this country, which the older people know, too. And they are being asked to question, the older ones, by the younger ones, why this taboo, why we couldn't talk about socialism, why we can't embrace a socialism. And on electability, my goodness, if we've seen anything in the last few years, we've seen the center, whether it's in Europe or this country, falling away, disappearing, center-left, center-right, for the extremes on the right, and now an extreme on the left. I don't find that frightening. I understand people who are centrists do, but I welcome that we can have an honest debate in this country, and there's much in the socialist tradition that is well worth keeping. There are lessons of what we should do, just like there are lessons of what we shouldn't do, which is true for capitalism as well. So we're opening things up, and I think when it comes to electability, we have as much to argue that this is the way forward as anyone on the other side.
By the way, I don't think the people who send me hate mail, and I am the king of hate mail, think that I'm a centrist, right? I'm for universal health care. I'm for deficit spending on infrastructure. I'm for universal child care. If that's centrism, then, you know, let's have it. By that standard, Denmark is centrist.
Right.
I want to, before we go to issues like Medicare for All, I want to turn to MSNBC and what's been happening over the weekend, a kind of meltdown on MSNBC around the issue of Bernie Sanders clearly looking like he's the front runner. And chief among those melting down appears to be MSNBC host Chris Matthews, who this weekend compared Senator Sanders' Nevada victory to Nazi Germany's takeover of France.
I'm reading last night about the fall of France in the summer of 1940, and the general, Renault, calls up Churchill and says, it's over. And Churchill said, how can it be? You got the greatest army in Europe. How can it be over? He said, it's over. So I had that suppressed feeling. I can't be as wild as Carville, but he is damn smart, and I think he's damn right on this one.
So Bernie Sanders' communications director, Mike Kaska, responded to Matthews' comment on Twitter saying, quote, never thought part of my job would be pleading with a national news network to stop likening the campaign of a Jewish presidential candidate whose family was wiped out by the Nazis to the Third Reich. But here we are. A number of people are now calling for Chris Matthews to resign. Paul Krugman.
Yes, I mean— Far be it from me to defend Chris Matthews, who I think has been a malign influence on a lot of our political discourse. I don't think he was actually calling Sanders a Nazi. He was just thinking of, this is what it looks like when you've lost. But it was stupid. It was stupid, and it was insensitive, and it was characteristic. I mean, if that's what centrism sounds like, this notion that calling for universal health care or stuff is some kind of extreme position. And no, I mean, it's telling you something about where Matthews' head is at and not something good. And it's unfortunately, I don't think it's unique. The fact of the matter is there's a lot of, I mean, Lloyd Blankfein saying, oh, you know, I might have to vote for Trump if Sanders is nominated.
And explain the significance of who Lloyd
Blankfein
is.
Goldman Sachs. And, you know, for God's sake, Trump might, Sanders might raise your taxes. That is not an important consideration. American democracy is on the line. So there are a lot of people out there who are, I'm not sure how many there are. There are a lot of influential people out there who are horrified by the prospect of a strongly progressive candidate. And that should be condemned. I just wish he wouldn't call himself a socialist.
Richard Wolff.
Well, I think politics is shifting, and the centrists are having to discover that they are centrists because the politics has moved to the left. That's what Bernie has accomplished. That's what the young people around him have accomplished. It may be awkward and uncomfortable for people who used to think of themselves as the left to discover they're not, that there's a movement to their left. But we're very proud that that has returned as a kind of sanity of balance in our political discourse. And so I'm not surprised that people like Matthews overreact because they're being outflanked on the left. They weren't ready for it. I remember in 2016 talking to a high official of the Democratic Party, assuring me that Bernie Sanders would never get more than 1 or 2% of any vote anywhere, ever. And they didn't know, and they didn't understand. And it's a little bit like the old Bob Dylan song, you know, wake up. There's things going on that you didn't foresee and that are shifting the ground on which you stand. But I want to be clear that many of us welcome this.
I mean, Chris Matthews has been on a tear. He recently said, I remember the Cold War. I have an attitude toward Fidel Castro. He added, I believe if Castro and the Reds had won the Cold War, there would have been executions in Central Park, and I might have been one of the ones executed, and certain other people would be there cheering. Suggesting, as he was talking about Bernie Sanders, that Bernie Sanders would be responsible for his execution in Central Park.
Yeah. For me, this is all that I hear in all of this is an anguished fear that the politics is moving to the left. These are individuals who made a commitment long ago in their lives not to go to the left, even if they had sympathies there, to stay in the middle because it was the safe, the wise thing for their future, for the country, and for their careers. And that's no longer the case, and they are outraged and outcome these kinds of comments.
We're going to break, then come back to this discussion. We're talking to two economists. Richard Wolff has a new book out. It's called Understanding Socialism. And the Nobel Prize-winning economist Paul Krugman has a new book out. It's called Arguing with Zombies, Economics, Politics, and the Fight for a Better Future. Stay with us. Answered by McCarthy. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As we continue our debate on Bernie Sanders and democratic socialism with Paul Krugman, Nobel Prize-winning economist, op-ed columnist for The New York Times, has a new book out called Arguing with Zombies, and Richard Wolff, emeritus professor of economics, University of Massachusetts Amherst, visiting professor at the New School. His book is called Understanding Socialism. So, Paul Krugman, I wanted to go to your one of your columns that you just wrote, headline, Bernie Sanders Isn't the Left's Trump, where you write, I'm more concerned about the electability of someone who says he's a socialist, even though he isn't, and if he does win, whether he'll squander political capital on unwinnable fights like abolishing private health insurance. Your stance on Medicare for all.
If I could do it, if I could wave a magic wand, or if I had a time machine and could somehow go back to 1947, when we almost got single-payer health care, I would do it in a moment. It's not the only way to do it. One thing you learn if you study healthcare systems is every other advanced country has universal healthcare. They do it in different ways. Some of them have government provisions. Some of them have regulated private healthcare. Some of them have single payer. Single payer is not the only solution, but it's fine. The trouble is there's 160 million people in America who have private health insurance. You're saying to those people, we're going to replace what you have with something completely different. Trust us, it'll be better. It will probably be true for most of them that it would be better, but that's a huge political lift. You're asking people to make a huge leap of faith, whereas we can, in fact, get to universal coverage through a public option, through a something like Medicare for America, but, something that lets people buy into Medicare and subsidizes it without having to waste that time. And there's so many, that's not— having the absolute best healthcare system is not the only priority. If I had to say what is the most biggest gap in America is that we're not doing enough to help children. And I would like to get another couple of percent of GDP spent on helping children in a variety of ways. And I think that the drive for Medicare for all will kill that possibility.
Interestingly, when you look at the polls in New Hampshire and in Nevada about what people care most about, in both places, it's the same. Number one is healthcare. Number two is climate change. Number three, I think it's inequality. Right. And number four, it's foreign policy. And especially in Nevada, Richard Wolff, what's interesting is you had a very powerful union, the Culinary Union, where they were offering excellent health insurance to their workers, and yet their workers overwhelmingly, the rank and file, bucked the leadership and said, even if we're getting great health care, we have family members who are not, loved ones who are not, and ultimately we want Medicare for all. So explain this discrepancy. Paul Krugman is saying it's not realistic.
Well, I think, again, the politics in America have changed. I don't think the mass of Americans want to hear the details about what you might get and how careful we should be and what step we should. They want change. They wanted it from Obama, who promised hope and change. They wanted it even from Mr. Trump, who promised a change. We didn't get the changes that they promised, neither the one nor the other. And so people now want something that will solve their problem, will not respect the old centrist, let's go carefully, let's do this, let's not push too hard.
So
they want
the
opposite.
How do you get to Medicare for all immediately or more rapidly than what Paul Krugman is suggesting?
Well, I agree with Paul, which surprises probably both of us. But the point is, there are plenty of models out there of countries that have, in a variety of ways, answered the basic human demand, I want to be careful, I want to know that when I'm born and until I die, if something happens to me in the way of illness or injury, I am taken care of. Like, I want a public park and I want public schools. I want public health care. And they don't want the details and the hesitance. They want that. And any of them would be a perfectly good basis.
You know, it's always interested me how people look to other countries to say what would be models when we have the model right here at home. We have Medicare, one of the most popular programs in this country.
Oh, yeah. We have socialized medicine for everybody over 65. And although it's interesting, if you look at it, we also do have private insurance. We have not abolished private supplemental insurance for older people in America. So it is, in a way, a bit of a compromise system. The actually existing Medicare that we have for older Americans is not as radical as the Medicare that Bernie Sanders is proposing for everyone. But look, the United States contains multitudes. We have pure socialized medicine. The Veterans Health Administration is actual government provision of health care, and it works. We have regulated private markets and Obamacare. I mean, people trash Obama a lot, but, given the constraints he was under, he got 20 million people health insurance, who didn't have it before. I personally know people whose lives were saved by Obamacare. So let's not dismiss it as nothing. And we have single payer, but you know that in ways of telling you that there are many ways to achieve it, and we should look at every other country does it for everybody. The problem is we have a safety net that's got huge holes in it.
Interestingly, this Yale study just came out in the medical journal Lancet. It said Medicare for All would save the U.S. $450 billion and prevent nearly 70,000 deaths a year. You have Bernie Sanders recently saying that he wants people in the movement to say, I'm willing to fight for someone I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I could match Paul's argument and his little model of somebody whose life was saved by introducing him to people whose life was lost, or at least their relatives, because they didn't have the coverage that Mr. Obama was unable to get. And for someone who kept saying, I could do more if only I had a groundswell of support, we do have to remember that when that groundswell developed, called Occupy Wall Street, Mr. Obama wiped it out with his bulldozers in Zuccotti Park and everywhere else, undercutting the very groundswell he had earlier used as an excuse for not doing more. But my response is, whether it's health care or a decent college education for Americans that doesn't saddle them with tens of thousands of dollars of debt, the demand is now out there. And that's what's fueling Mr. Bernie Sanders' support. They don't want the middling biddle, this change, that. They want these problems that, Paul is right, have existed in this country for many years. They want it finally solved, and they want a politician who they can believe might actually do it, as opposed to those in the middle who have been saying it and promising it and belaboring the difficulties and basically not getting it done.
One of your columns, Paul Krugman, you talk about the headline is, have zombies eaten Bloomberg's and Buttigieg's brains?
Yes.
Explain.
Okay. That was mostly—so my book is arguing with zombies, and one of the zombies is this obsession with public debt and the belief that you know, we should be terribly scared of government debt, and we can't do anything because deficits eek. That's the way Buttigieg talks now. At the very moment when mainstream economics, if you like centrist economics, has concluded, hey, these debt worries were way overblown. You know, the president of the American Economic Association gave this presidential address saying, you know, debt is just not nearly the problem people think it is, and it's not a constraint. And, of course, Republicans have pulled one of the greatest acts of policy hypocrisy in history. You know, deficits were an existential threat as long as Obama was in office. They don't matter as soon as Trump is in office. So I really don't want to see—if we did get a Democratic centrist who bought into this deficit scaremongering, that would be a really bad thing. That would block any kind of initiative.
And as we begin to wrap up, there is a presidential debate coming up on Tuesday night in South Carolina. Two of the seven candidates are billionaires.
Yeah.
Richard Wolff, your thoughts?
Well, for me, it is always an astonishment to observe this inequality getting worse and worse. I'm one of the people, even though I wasn't alive then, who celebrated that during the 1930s, we compressed the inequality in this country by means of an unusual president whose politics are remarkably like that of Mr. Bernie Sanders these days. And we actually did something to lessen the inequality. And as soon as the war was over, we resumed, we undid the New Deal, and the inequality began to get to the crazy levels now. It is an abomination that one person, for example, Jeffrey Bezos, disposes of $100+ billion, deciding what is to be done with all those resources. That's not democratic. That excludes the mass of people from the needs that could be met if that money was used differently, and he can hardly consume it himself. It's an extraordinary critique of capitalism that it allows this kind of concentrated wealth, which of course protects itself by trying to control the politics of our country so that they don't have the power in Congress to undo the inequality in the first place. So for me, declaiming against that, right on, Bernie Sanders.
I mean, I don't think that billionaires are inherently evil, but there is something wrong when two guys who really don't have any kind of national political base are in this debate only because of their money. The peculiar thing is, of course, that Steyer may well make Bernie Sanders the nominee by drawing support away from Biden. But no, this is—I mean, as these guys go—
10 seconds.
Bloomberg is not evil, but he shouldn't be in this race.
We want to leave it there for the moment, but of course we will continue to cover all of this during this 2020 election year. We will be doing a 5-hour special on Super Tuesday night from 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time right through midnight. I want to thank Paul Krugman, Nobel Prize winning economist, op-ed columnist for The New York Times. He is the author of numerous books, his latest, Arguing with Zombies. So much to Richard Wolff, author of the new book, Understanding Socialism. That does it for our broadcast. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much.